Everywhere you look these days, it seems like someone's either on their iPhone, their iPad, or they're wearing their AirPods or an Apple Watch. And with a market value of over $2 trillion, it seems like everything those wise guys at Apple touch turns to gold. But that ain't necessarily the truth. Pull up a pew, and I'll tell you all about the 10 times when the geniuses over at Apple made themselves look like a total bunch of schmucks. Number 10. E-World. Back in the days when the internet was still a novelty, the average man on the street had no idea what it could do. Into companies like AOL, which gave people a way to get online, while also telling them what it was all about through applications and an easy-to-use interface. Apple tried to provide a similar service, which they called E-World. It looked like a child's drawing of a small town. It was supposed to serve as a metaphor for the web. You know, like the community center is where you can chat to strangers and the marketplace is where you can buy your questionables, and that kind of thing. It might have worked if Apple's dial-up prices weren't so high, and if E-World wasn't exclusive to Macs, which only counted for around 5% of computer sales at the time. The service was dead less than 2 years after it launched. Number 9. Lisa. Believe it or not, there was a time when computers didn't even have graphics at all. It was all text, no images. Kinda like the messages between me and my ex-wife. Many people believe that Apple's first computer with a GUI, that's a graphical user interface, by the way, came with the first Mac, which was launched in 1984. That's because nobody likes to talk about the huge flop that came before it. Given the name Lisa, the first Apple computer to use a GUI came a full year earlier, in 1983. It was powered by a measly 5 MHz Motorola 68000 processor. Simply put, it was slower than my mother reading an encyclopedia. Not to mention, it cost a ridiculous $9,995, which adjusted for inflation is over $25,000 in today's money. That's extortionate. Unsurprisingly, hardly anybody bought the Lisa. The Mac soon came out and was 60% faster, featuring an upgraded 8 MHz processor. Number 8. Mac OS clones. The Apple company might be raking in profits these days, but back in 1994, their finances, they weren't doing so well. You see, making your products exclusive is a bit of a double-edged sword. You'll either dominate the market or fade away from it. Whereas Microsoft allowed their operating system to run on a variety of PCs, Apple stood firm until 1995 by only allowing Mac OS to be run exclusively on Mac computers. When they finally relented, they granted Mac OS licenses to clone makers like Power Computing, as well as companies like Motorola and UMax. However, while this strategy had worked well for Microsoft, it was a disaster for Apple. They found that it just ate right into their profits, because although people were buying their software and they were getting a cut for it, few people were buying Apple hardware, which is where the big money is. Steve Jobs put an end to the Mac clones when he returned to the business in 1997, and that's why you ain't likely to see Mac OS again on any computer except an Apple product anytime soon. Number 7. Newton. You guys remember when Palm Pilots and PDAs, those personal digital assistants, were the next big thing? Well, if you don't, you obviously ain't as old as me. Before their more popular mobile devices, Apple unveiled the Newton. It was basically a mini portable computer. One of its standout features was that you could write on the screen using a stylus, and it would transform into digital text. Only, it didn't exactly work so well. The Newton and its flaws were openly mocked on Saturday Night Live and The Simpsons, as well as in other forms of media at the time. And just like he did with the Mac OS clones, Jobs quickly put an end to the Newton and swept it right under the rug. Number 6. Hockey Puck Mouse. The next one doesn't need too much explaining. Just by looking at the product, you can already tell it wasn't exactly a winner. The boffins at Apple felt differently, though, when they revealed what they called the best mouse ever created in 1998. People were quick to rename it to the Hockey Puck, and its circular design caused hand cramps and difficulty telling which was the right way up. Apple did release an updated mouse with a notch at the top and an attachment to make it more like a regular mouse. which is pretty much accepting defeat if you ask me. The colorful, see-through plastic was a nice touch, but its functionality was awful, and there's a reason why the design didn't last so long. Number 5. Apple III. In 1980, Apple attempted to create a personal computer for the business market. The Apple III had some unique features, including an astonishing 512 kilobytes of memory. Yeah, it was actually a lot at the time. Plus a fanless design, which meant the computers ran quietly. As has become the theme for Apple, they asked a stupendously high price for their new machines. They wanted customers to pay anywhere between $3,495 and $4,995 for an Apple III in 1980. I mean, even by today's standards, that amount is expensive for a PC. The computers that they did manage to convince people to buy had one glaring problem. That fanless design meant that computers regularly overheated. Who could have seen that coming, right? I mean, when they overheated, components came loose, which made the PCs pretty much non-operational. Believe it or not, advice from Apple at the time was to drop the machine from a height of 2 inches to try and reset the chips that had come loose. I mean, imagine working for the tech support during that era. The III was the Apple's first major embarrassment, but it was nowhere near its last. Number 4. Lemmings Commercial. This next entry serves as a cautionary tale. If someone ain't available, don't hire the brother thinking they can do as good of a job. Award-winning director Ridley Scott made a commercial for Apple in 1984. It has been hailed as one of the best commercials of all time. It was called 1984 and had a dark but inspirational tone. When Apple went back to Ridley asking for a follow-up commercial, he was too busy, so Apple hired his brother, Tony. And the advert that Tony made was just, it was just weird. It was called Lemmings, and it shows blindfolded businessmen walking off the edge of a cliff until a voiceover announces that the Macintosh office is coming soon and people should look into it. Rather than daring or inspirational, people just found it insulting, and it didn't work out well for Apple, and Microsoft pushed ahead in the market race soon after. Number 3. Power Mac G4 Cube. Some people might find this entry a little controversial because the Power Mac G4 Cube was a good-looking machine, and it's so pretty that it's even on display in the New York Museum of Modern Art. Hey, but looks ain't everything though, trust me. And once again, Apple got greedy with this one. They expected people to pay $1,799 for a base model cube. It didn't even come with a monitor. Considering they could opt for a Power Mac G4 tower that costs $200 less, it wasn't exactly an attractive enough proposition. The Cube sold poorly, and Apple pulled it from their product line just 12 months after it was released. I mean, God forbid they just lowered their prices a little, I mean, come on. Number 2. Copland. After Apple had come up with a pretty decent operating system, the Mac OS, in 1984, they spent the next 17 years trying to keep it alive so that it could stay relevant and compete with more modern operating systems. The company knew they would have to come up with something new eventually, rather than just adding it to the old OS. So, in 1994, they started an internal project called Copland. They spent millions of dollars developing a modern operating system with new features like true multi-user support and protected memory. However, 2 years down the line, with only one preview of Copland shown to software developers, then CEO Jill Amelio pulled the plug and canceled the project in favor of just buying Steve Jobs' creation, NEXT, with its much-admired OpenStep OS. 2 years of hard work and millions of dollars went down the drain in an instant, although it did bring Steve Jobs back to Apple after he'd been ousted in 1985, and that's a pretty expensive silver lining. Number 1. Pippin. And I ain't talking Scotty. Finally, you ever heard of a gaming console called Pippin? I'm guessing not, because not many people have. Seeing that there was a quick buck to be made in gaming, Apple tried launching their own system in the mid-90s. Rather than start from scratch and waste money on research and development, though, they simply repackaged the Macintosh Classic 2 and added a controller to make it appear like a games console. Apple tested the waters with Pippin in Japan, where it was up against the PlayStation, and then briefly tried launching Pippin in America, the same year Nintendo 64 was released. And you don't need me to tell you how things turned out for Apple and their Pippin. But for clarification, the console was shelved less than a year after it hit the store shelves. What'd I tell you? Turns out they's human after all. Feels good to serve them a little humble pie to go along with all those apples, am I right? Anyway, if you liked the video, go ahead and tell me about it by leaving a thumbs up and sharing it with a few of your pals. Oh, and if you haven't already, go ahead and subscribe and click the bell icon. I ain't gonna be sending out invitations every time I upload if the computer can do it for me. Hey, I appreciate you watching till the end though. You have yourself a nice day and I'll catch you here for the next one. Take it easy.